appreciate Blake and Clark standing up there to read about these pesky lawyers and the scribes who are bothering Jesus. Also, as Erica just shared with the children, four of our young guys who were participating in the confirmation have been at Camp Glisten this weekend. They should be on their way back home right now. And Amanda and Justin have been with them over the weekend as they've been exploring the vows that we ask new members to make when they join the local United Methodist Church, to support the church with their prayers, their presence, their giving, their service, and their witness. So please be in prayer for all of them, especially for these four young men as they prepare to make that decision. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask now that you open our hearts and minds, that as we hear this familiar story, we will still be surprised by the gracious word you speak to our hearts and lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen. A certain man had two sons. It's a story about a father. It is perhaps one of the church's most familiar stories. It is also often one of our most misunderstood or misinterpreted stories. A certain man had two sons. Often the story is retold in a way that puts the emphasis on one of the sons. Most of us probably know this story as the story of the prodigal son. And the story is retold in such a way to highlight the things that the young man does and how he goes off and squanders his inheritance and then reaches the point of utter demise and rehearses his speech of contrition and comes running back to his father. And the story then is used to tell us how we shouldn't put our hopes and worldly pleasures and how we should learn to be penitent. But don't take your eyes off the father. It's a story about the father. A certain man had two sons. A certain man had two sons. Other retellings will highlight the elder son, the one who stays at home, the one who fulfills all of his duties, and yet when his brother comes home and his father throws a party for him, stands outside. Such retellings are meant to remind us that we shouldn't be too judgmental, we shouldn't be too legalistic, we shouldn't be too condemning of one another. Not that those aren't things we shouldn't be, but the story is not about the elder son either. The story is about a father. A certain man had two sons. Maybe it's because it's one of our most familiar stories that we often retell the stories in ways that are meant to kind of bring new meaning and new insight to it. One preacher's trick that we often resort to is we'll do a sermon that's told from the perspective of one of the characters in the story. I remember a seminary professor of mine remarking one day in class that he'd heard so many different versions of this story preached. He'd heard it told from the perspective of the younger son. He'd heard it told from the perspective of the elder son. He'd heard it told from the perspective of the servant. He'd heard it told from every perspective except for the perspective of the fatted cat. And he was waiting for one of us to do that. Story about a father. certain men had two sons. And one of the things required to be a parent is to have children. Whether it's one or more, to be a parent, in the biological sense, you have children, or through adoption, you have children that you care for and love. This father happens to have two sons. The younger son comes to him one day, and he says, in essence, "Dad, I'd like you to drop dead." That's what his request is. "I'd like my share of the inheritance." Notice he doesn't ask, "I'd like to know what my inheritance will be." "I would like it right now." In those days, and at that time, it was already prescribed what his inheritance was going to be. The older brother was going to get 2/3 of his father's estate. The younger brother would get 1/3. There is no doubt in his mind what his inheritance will be. Maybe there's some doubt if they sell some things off, how much financially it would actually be. But he knows what his inheritance will be. He is asking to go ahead and receive it while his father is still living. He is saying, "Dad, I am ready to just act as if you're dead." And even when he gets the inheritance, that's not enough for him. He goes to this far country. He goes as far away from home as he possibly can, it seems. He goes into an entirely different culture. And there he's having these parties, and he's using his inheritance to enjoy whatever he wants to enjoy. About the time the inheritance runs out, there's this famine in the land. And we see this son sink to what the hearers, the people who are hearing Jesus' story, would imagine as the worst possible condition. He becomes someone who feeds the pigs. And remember, Jesus is talking to Jewish people for whom pigs are unclean animals. You don't want to be around pigs. It's not that you just don't eat pigs. It's that you don't even want to be around them. And this is the guy who's now in charge of feeding the pigs. And his life has gotten so bad that he lusts after the food that he's feeding the pigs. That looks appetizing to him. And it's at that point that he starts to come to himself. He begins the journey back to his true identity. He realizes that in his father's house, even the servants eat better than him. He's not yet ready to go back and to reclaim his status as a son. He doesn't think that's possible, but he does think it's possible to go back and to be a servant in that house and at least be better treated than what he's being treated now. But the idea of being reclaimed and welcomed back as a son is something that he can't even think or fathom. Listen to it as he rehearses that speech in his mind. "Father, I am no longer worthy to be called your son, but let me just be one of the servants." So with his speech rehearsed, he begins the journey back home. And as he's walking down the road, you can imagine him walking, still rehearsing that speech in his mind and on his lips, and probably with his head hung down, the closer he gets to home, because now he's got to go back to all those people who witnessed his rash action, his going to his father and asking for his inheritance and then wandering off. He's not only got to face his father, but all those people who witnessed it. So he probably doesn't even see that they're coming down the road towards him just as fast as he can is the father. Father doesn't wait on the porch for the son to reach him. It says that the father sees the son coming. The father has been out there every day looking for, waiting for signs of his son's return. And when he sees him coming down the road, the father lights out and he goes and meets his son on the road. And as the son starts to begin his rehearsed speech, the father just reaches out and surrounds him. Brings up two sons, and as they go back to the house and begin the celebration, the welcome home party, the elder son is coming in from the fields. The elder son, who has obeyed all the rules, it seems like. He's been obedient, he's been dutiful, he's been out working in the fields that very day. And as he's approaching the house, he can hear the sound of merriment from this great banquet that the father is throwing, and he's confused. I mean, it's a Wednesday afternoon. Who parties on Wednesday afternoon, right? And he calls the servant, and he says, "What's going on? Has an old man lost his mind? It's not even Friday." I guess Thursday, since they're Jewish, and Friday didn't. Child be welcome at your hands. Sometimes Sometimes we find ourselves in the place of the younger son, and saying, God, why should I be at that table? And yet God reaches out to all of us, no matter where we find ourselves today, to say, because you're my child. You're my daughter. You're my son. And all I've ever wanted was for you to come to the party. Thanks be to God. Part of our tradition in the season of Lent is to offer up our prayers of confession. The times when we have failed to live out God's wrath and love. And in response to our sermon this morning, I want to invite you to turn to the back of your hymnals to number 890 for the prayer of confession. Hear what words of comfort the Scriptures offers all those who confess their sins. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Thank you.